All right. Is everybody ready for the final presentation of day one? Yeah. Woo! All right. How about a warm welcome for our next presenter, Eric Loyd?
Thank you. My name is Eric Loyd. I'm the founder and CEO of Bitnetics Incorporated. Real quick, a little bit about myself and Bitnetics. We are a predominantly voice over IP technology company, provide both custom phone solutions for business to business, as well as VoIP services. We also provide IT and network consulting. I've worked for 25 years in IT at places like Eastman Kodak, which we'll talk about today, Frontier Communications, which is the main telephone company in Rochester, New York, which is where I'm from, and Global Crossing, which some of you may have heard of. We started our seventh year in this past July, so I'm happy about that. And we were a 2012 Great Awards finalist in the communications technology field for a main networking group in Rochester. We use Nagios to monitor our equipment. We use Nagios to monitor our voice over IP platform, and we use it to monitor our clients' equipment. We've been doing this at Kodak since 2004 when I started there as a contractor. So briefly, a quick rundown of the history of Nagios at Eastman Kodak. Real quick, how many people have actually heard of Eastman Kodak, the company formerly known as the little yellow box before they go bankrupt? So this is a non-confidential presentation, so you won't get any machine names or anything like that that you can go try to find on the network, hopefully. If you do, you didn't hear it from me. So, come on, little button, do your thing. My little button's not working. There we go. So in 2004 is when we moved to a new platform. So prior to 2004, they were running with machines located in Rochester, New York, which is where the corporate headquarters are for Kodak. They have a collection, or had a collection, of public Apache servers, back-end application servers, reverse proxy servers, some database machines, and production support boxes. And I want to clarify something. We're talking about the Kodak.com platform, which is not managing all of Kodak's IT infrastructure. This is just managing the website that is Kodak.com and the various applications, sitelets, and services that that website provides, both to consumers as well as to the business-to-business world that Kodak works in. At one time, Kodak was a very large company, especially in the Rochester area. They were the number one employer, 90 plus some odd thousand people that they had working there, a couple $1 billion a year in revenue, a lot of consumer film. Anybody remember film? They transitioned to a digital company, and a few years later, which is now about a year ago, filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy protection. In 2004, they hired a few people, including myself, as contractors, to move this platform to an undisclosed third-party data center located somewhere on the eastern seaboard. So we moved these machines from Rochester, which meant we had to incorporate the firewalls to get traffic from development boxes that were still in the Rochester area out to this new facility and back. We had to deal now with bandwidth requirements that were being provided by a third party and make sure that we weren't going above our limits. We needed to make sure, perhaps most importantly, that this was done with minimal user impact, so that when you went to sleep on Friday night and you logged off your Kodak.com shopping cart, that when you logged in Monday morning, it was still there waiting for you to buy things. Because at the time, consumer marketing was the department that owned the Kodak.com website. They thought of it as an arm of their marketing department. And in the consumer division, that's how they sold film, printers, digital cameras, whatever those things are, and some other things. A lot of this was driven through the marketing department through the website. So there needed to be basically a flip the switch, go live type thing. And we actually managed to accomplish that. So I'm very proud we did this in about 3 months. And what the website did at the time, to give you an idea of kind of how big this was, is, of course, there's consumer store and product information. There's the business-to-business portal, wholesaler purchasing, so Walmart would buy all of their one-time use cameras through the website. There's this thing called Picture of the Day where you can take a picture, submit it through the website, have it show up on a big marquee display in Times Square, which is really kind of neat because you can go to New York City and take a picture of yourself standing in front of your picture. Professional photo labs do calibrations at least once a week. They'd send those strips back through the website. You can kind of read this. Phone home stuff from the various software products and printers and camera docks and things that would tell Kodak how many pieces of paper you'd printed so they knew when to start marketing you ink, for instance. A host of other things, which really don't matter. There were basically dozens of different ways that Kodak used the website to communicate with its customers as well as to get information back from these various pieces of equipment that are out there. At the time, there was no monitoring for this software or for this system when it was moved. So they needed something. And the idea was, well, let's do something quick, something easy, and especially cheap. So why Nagios? Well, unfortunately, with no centralized monitoring software in place at that time at Kodak, it meant that there was nothing to compete with from a business process or a departmental standpoint. You didn't have to ask the IT people. Remember, we're marketing people at this point. We don't have to ask the IT people, can we run Nagios? Because they don't have anything that they can deploy, so we could put out whatever it was that we wanted. Since there wasn't anything already there, it also meant we had to start with ground zero, a green field, which pluses and minuses to that. The cost was an obvious factor. There is none, except for people to do the work. And since they already had predominantly a contractor workforce in place and about 8 full-time staff that managed the website and its servers and services, the human cost was already in place, basically. The framework to provide Nagios, or the framework that Nagios had to work in, was that it needed to work with these now complex firewall rules that were in place between Rochester and the remote locations. We did not have the ability to install agents on the remote machines, and I suppose this would be a good point to mention that this was all Solaris-based. There's no Windows, there's no Linux at this point. This is all Solaris 2. I don't remember what, something ancient, 8 maybe. And the development platform is located in Rochester still. The production platform and a staging environment is at this other location. So there ended up actually being 2 instances of Nagios that were deployed. In order to get through these firewalls, it was decided that anything that we could monitor that didn't require us to actually be on the remote machine to get that information was a good way to do it. So a lot of information that we could obtain through HTTP requests by either looking at web pages or delving into code that were installed in the applications that got deployed that would tell us things about what that application was doing internally, memory usage and things like that. SSH was a big tool for us because it allowed us to actually, and we'll get into this later, wrap our modules, our Nagios modules, into SSH tunnels, which we could then execute on the remote hosts. They could execute local arbitrary code, return the results back, and everything could be managed from a local Nagios box at using active checks, no passive checks. Again, this is 2004, so this is pre-core versus XI kind of thing. So this is Nagios. I think when I started, this was Nagios 1.9, if I remember right. They since upgraded to 2.4 or 5, and only in this past summer moved to 3.4. It was very important to have these custom checks that you can only get with Nagios, really, with the modules that you can install yourself. Because of the complex nature of the applications that Kodak ran, the checks weren't simply, is the machine up, is, you know, how much memory is being used. It's actually, we were delving into order processing transaction chains within the consumer and business websites to try to determine what it looks like from a user's perspective as well. So we needed to be able to do these custom checks. In fact, with very few exceptions, even to this day, every module that is being run by the Kodak Nagios that's monitoring this platform today is a custom module that was written mostly by me at this point. So obviously there's some problems in getting there. And the biggest one is what the network looks like. So on the left-hand side in green is sort of the production environment. The right-hand side in yellow is a staging environment, which is a pared-down version of production. But every piece of code, every piece of content had to go through staging in order to get out to production. Let's hope that that actually was followed. So there were load balancers that existed on public IPs. There's a firewall that separates that from now Kodak's public IP space, where there's sort of load balancing proxy or Apache proxies, basically. I'm a step ahead there. Now we move inside of Kodak's private IP space, where we have reverse proxies that sit between them, yet another firewall where the application servers are and databases and so forth. So this is the level at which a single request from a user on the internet would make to just look at a camera product page, for instance, would have to go all the way down to the bottom of this and come back out to actually get that information on their browser. So it's a complex environment. There's multiple environments, staging, production, there's a development platform back in Rochester again. So on top of all this are the back-end machines like our Nagios machine that monitors all these things, a couple of production support boxes. And this is kind of a pared-down picture. There really were about 89 machines by the time all was said and done that were moved to the new data center. So firewalls were our biggest hurdle. With the public load balancers on external internet IPs, I kind of said this all with the last slide here, so I'm just going to browse through this real quick. Our Nagios, actually back up here, the Nagios machine that did the monitoring was actually at the bottom of that stack. So it was in the most secure zones that Kodak had for this network, which means in order to actually check some of the things higher up, it would actually go out, connect to that front-end proxy, and come back down to do some of these checks. We'll, again, get into that in a minute, too. So we called these our top and our bottom checks. Anything that Nagios could check from its secured location at the bottom and move up through that stack, it would be a bottom check from the bottom up. Anything where it had to come through one of those public proxies to kind of see what the user was seeing, those are our top checks. So we can see, is the site working from a user's perspective? Which, let's face it, that's the goal. We want to make sure that we're providing a functioning website. But on the other side, we want to make sure that the application components are working as well. So this allowed us to separate what looked like failure from the user standpoint, or perhaps failure from an application, a running application instance standpoint, and determine, is it really something that is going to be a check mark on a downtime report because we're not providing service, or is it simply that one of our four web servers is down, or one of the 15 Tomcat application server instances is not running? So in the beginning, there was no internal Nagios knowledge. I will admit, I didn't have any Nagios knowledge the day that I was told I was going to be spearheading this project at Kodak. So in the end, it was me, contractor, keyword in quotes there, who set this up for Kodak. Contractors typically have a finite lifespan at Kodak. They last for about 24 months before they're invited or escorted out of the building, and they're not invited back for at least another year. The idea being that Kodak has actual staff that they should be using to do the work, and contractors should just be a short-term resource. So unfortunately, I'm the one that made all these custom checks. I made all the event handlers that we'll talk about. I did all the configurations. So this is starting to look like a problem from Kodak's perspective. They still didn't have, at this point, a local knowledge source for Nagios. We needed to be able to escalate things, notify. We needed to page an on-call systems administrator. Actually, what they call systems administrator would be more like an application owner. The people who manage the applications that are the Kodak.com website are not the same people that manage the machines that they ran on. So the people that ran the machines were concerned about pings and whether or not the machine was up, but they didn't care one whit about whether or not Apache was running. That wasn't their problem. So the application development or application owners, which is the team that I was working with, was responsible for making sure that all of these components were actually working. So the idea was, screw it, we're all on one team, let's just have an email go out every time there's a problem. It'll go to everybody on the team. We'll let Thunderbird filters sort out what things should be in the end and who's supposed to get what. We had one phone that was passed around to the on-call person every week. Everybody got their rotation. So paging was done to the on-call phone through a text gateway. So, you know, phone number at Verizon.com kind of thing, or whatever the appropriate email address is, which has its own problems, which means if our mail service is not working, then we don't get escalations and pages. However, the good news is the group that managed Kodak.com is not the group that manages the email service. So if you think like a 90,000 plus employee corporation, it's not our problem. Don't have to worry about email services. Today, We now have a Twitter API that I've put in place that actually fires things out to Twitter, and we'll get more into that as well, that we use as the primary notification method. It's a lot nicer than emails on a phone in the middle of the night. So we leveraged SSH as the primary means to do these checks. We have a Nagios server that runs in the data center that's on the west or on the East Coast, and it is managing all the active checks for all these machines running all the services in that data center. There's no passive checks, there's no NRPE, there's no NSCA, there's none of this stuff. It's all active checks. In order to manage these active checks, we need to be able to get data from that machine that can only be generated on that machine back into Nagios. So we have a Nagios user that has a Nagios home directory, that has a Nagios SSH key that is empty passphrase, that can SSH to all these remote hosts as the application owner account on that host. So for the sake of argument, if there's a Tomcat application running on the host, there's a Tomcat user that owns that application, Nagios can SSH in as Tomcat user, therefore can get information about the Tomcat service that's running, and in the future when there's an event handler, can actually do things like restart that. So SSH was very important. Anytime we added additional software, we could add additional sort of what they called robot accounts that owned that software or ran that software, just add another key, and now Nagios can control that piece of software on the remote host as well. Any existing modules that are sort of stock modules that came with Nagios at the time, check load, for instance, there's no real reason to rewrite a check load module, but by itself it can't execute through an SSH tunnel. So we had custom versions of a sort of a generic wrapper that could execute Nagios modules on the remote host through these SSH tunnels. And this was done in a way that kind of ensured that the module was only being executed from a certain directory on the remote host. It was only being run from an SSH tunnel that was being executed from our Nagios host. It was kind of some security stuff built in there. So you couldn't just go to the remote host and execute the command on your own. And I'm going to apologize now. I probably should have done this before. I'm not really going to get into the details about like the SSH connections and things like that. It's kind of a high-level overview, and I'm sort of assuming a certain level of Unix systems administration knowledge. So I apologize. You can catch me later if you want to get any further details about some of these things. So with this SSH wrapper that we have, now we can do sort of a pre-work setup. We can actually SSH and do the work, and then we can do kind of a post-work, whatever we want to do. And so in this case, we can do some additional error controls, some handling with that. We can do some additional notifications that are sort of out of band of the normal Nagios notification system for specific checks that might have weird sort of non-binary output. And we can log all of the results of our checks directly to an SQL database, which in this case was an Oracle database. Quick note, you can read this on your own, but I'll tell you what it says. Every check that ran had output that included all the sort of standard variables that you would get in that service configuration line, along with the output and the state and performance data, was logged to an Oracle database. The way we did this was rather than do this in band with the check so that in case Oracle wasn't available, the check would hang, Nagios would hang, and bad things would ensue, we actually had all of our scripts, again, remember the modules were all custom at this point. They're all at least inside of a wrapper that Kodak controlled. So the end result was the wrapper would fire off a piece of Perl code that used Perl file locking to lock a status file. It would dump the results of the check in the status file, unlock the file, and then it would finish. So in theory, file locking is pretty quick. We could get the results into this file very fast without having to worry about blocking anything else within Nagios. There's a cron job that woke up every 5 minutes or so and locked this file, read through the 10,000 or so service checks that had been issued in that time frame, logged those as a block into Oracle. Anything that didn't successfully log into Oracle was saved in kind of a bad output file for manual processing. File got cleared and unlocked. So these two things kind of happened sort of, well, Nagios did it whenever it wanted to. The logging would happen whenever it needed to every 5 minutes. And then once a day we had another job which went through the Oracle database, got rid of anything older than 400 days, took anything older than 30 days, and eliminated successive checks that were the same status. so that we were consolidating anything that was okay. We didn't need to keep 400 versions of that. We could just keep, it was okay here, and then it was bad here. So we could go back and do some analysis of what our platform was doing over time. Anything 30 days or newer, it was kept in its entirety. A lot of management of our configuration files. We start with SCCS, which is Solaris's version. We call it our poor man's CVS. SCCS is essentially a file-based, repository. We'll go with that. It lets you lock a single file. You can unlock a single file. You can check in a single file. You're working on a single file on a file system. So it's not like CVS or SVN or any of these other things where you're looking at directories or trees. You're looking at just one file. In the, we'll say, dozen or so files that exist within the Nagios world, that's okay. It was good enough for us. It comes with Solaris 2 whatever, so it was already pre-installed. There's no additional cost, et cetera. Because SCCS was used by the development team to manage their code, which I really can't imagine writing code just using SCCS as your repository, there was an existing knowledge base with that as well. So it was a lot easier than trying to integrate Subversion into Solaris 8, for instance, which I still have to resort to Java to make that work. Today, it's actually managed through Subversion because this platform, back in July, was actually migrated to Linux hosts. Things are a lot easier today. But back then, again, we're talking 8 years ago or so, and really up until this summer, everything was through Subversion, or through SCCS. I don't know why this is in the wrong order. So rsync was our main tool for moving stuff from the host that had SCCS on it, where everybody went and modified configuration files in this configuration repository and push directory, or what we affectionately call the crap. So you'd log into the machine that had the crap on it, you'd go to the crap, you'd edit your appropriate file, and then you'd execute a CF engine. I'm going to get to the end of here. Using a make file that kind of provided some poor man's interfaces into how this stuff worked, you could push the crap to the remote machine through rsync, and then the make file would SSH to that machine and run a local version of CFEngine, which ran to move things from its version of the crap out to the production directories where those configuration files needed to be. And if you're familiar at all with CFEngine, it gives you a lot of ability to kind of do things in a template manner, so you can put machine names, IP addresses, and things like that in there, and it can fill it in on the fly. But it's also really good about following directions. And some of the directions are, we don't want to blow away PID files, for instance, on a running application server because things will go crazy. So we have a lot of rules in the CFEngine configuration that would tell it how to put these files out on the production machine in a production directory that's already running production code. So the event handler, EK, Eastman, Kodak, just want to clear that mystery up here real quick. We had one event handler that we ran for every service, EK restart. It started out as the thing that would restart our Apache servers when the Apache servers went bad. But it eventually grew into something that it was easier just to have one event handler for everything and use some shell programming trickery to make it smart than it was to recreate the wheel for each one of our applications. So the way EK restart works, there's a setup phase, and we're being fired off from Nagios. A check has returned whatever the result is. It's following its normal event handler forking to give us access to elements about the service check. So we're getting arguments from Nagios. We're going to do some, I call it conversions, where we take things that are in Nagios and we convert them into things that are useful to us at the application level. And in order to make this work, we made use of machine names that were based on what class of machine they were, and they all had a sequential number so that we could do math based on the number to get information about like what ports the applications were using, for instance. It's kind of way complex to go in here, but we have Apache classes, and we had Tomcat classes and database classes. And then the machines were numbered 1, 2, or 3, 4, or 5, 6. So you know on the Apache servers that Apache ports running on non-standard ports are going to be a function of the name of the machine as well as the number of the machine. So within our restart, we know the port numbers for all of our Apache instances. The names of the services that were configured in Nagios were something, colon, something, colon, something, so that we could get more and more specific as we moved through the name, so that we would start with, for instance, Apache, colon, consumer, colon, number one, and we knew that this was a consumer Apache, it was the number one instance, so when we do that port math, we knew which port to use. This is actually only mostly useful when we finally get down here into this do restart. So after we do these conversions to make useful information out of what Nagios gives us, it takes a look at whether we got a soft restart or a hard restart, and if we're supposed to do something based on that. And if we are supposed to do something, well, then we go do it, and that's the do restart that you'll see. So do restart does some file locking to make sure that the restart that we're about to execute doesn't conflict with Nagios, or that the restart we're about to kick off doesn't conflict with some of the other processes that are in place with some of the automation that was within the environment. We fire some logging off. We fire some monitoring output out into our SQL database. We make use of this little thing we'll talk about a little bit later called Send Nagios, which is our API we generated to be able to do external commands, for instance. So again, we know the name of our machines. We know the name of our service. They're all carefully crafted. So within here, we actually know all the names of our service groups because they're all algorithmically defined. So we can fire off a check command, or excuse me, a external command to Nagios to tell it to stop monitoring all the service groups that this machine or this service is affiliated with so that Nagios is not jumping on our restart as we're trying to restart a service that we know is not functioning properly. It SSHs to the remote machine. It fires off an exact copy of itself, except now it's being told it's a remote version. The remote version will process its arguments. It will execute a function internally called do underscore the name of the service. It then kind of reverses this and tears down the connection. So it does this external check to enable, or external command to enable Nagios service checks. It then unlocks files. It logs to a file again. It logs to our SQL database. And it terminates. So inside this remote connection, if we kind of go from do service up here, what this remote version of EK restart, which is now running as the SSH command target on the remote machine, more locks. So now we've locked here. We're actually, this is being executed on the Nagios host. So the Nagios host is locking files here. This is being executed on the actual target host. So it's locking things here. The reason for that is there's actually other things that are coming in and perhaps restarting things on a regular basis to do log file rotation. So we want to make sure we don't have one of those coming in and trying to restart something that we're in the middle of restarting. Lots of lock files, too many lock files. You'll see that in a minute. We do this sort of remapping of our instances like I talked about earlier. We do look at our ports and things to try to figure out programmatically, given the name in Nagios, what's the actual command that we're going to use to restart it. And then we fire off this do underscore Apache or do underscore Tomcat or do underscore something function within the shell script, which does those restarts. That's the app restart. And then we email people saying that we restarted stuff. We log things, we exit, we tear down, and all this kind of falls back as it returns. So this is sort of shell version of what I just talked about. I think I got all the good bits in and all the proprietary bits out. But you can see mostly this is the very first thing that we do is if we are being passed a minus R as our first parameter, then we are being executed on the remote host. So bail out of here and go to the client version, which is on the next slide or so. If we're being run on the Nagios host itself, we're going to get some stuff passed into us out of Nagios from the event handler script that's being passed in. We take our service name, which would be, for instance, that Apache colon consumer colon port number, and we extract parts of it so that we know we're just an Apache service. What state we're in, whether we're hard or soft, how many times we've done this in the past, any performance data. And then this is the class of machine, so this would be Apache, for instance. And then the next line would be the number. And we do this based on the name of the machine. So all the names of the machines are something-something-class. I can't say that. something-something-class-number.kodak.com. So based on this, we can pull out the name, pull out the class machine and the number, and then do some stuff. So based on the state, if it's okay, we do something like an event handler for recovery, which we call do fix it. And there's very little things that actually executed on recovery, so we're kind of ignoring that right now. If it was a warning state, we're going to do nothing. If it was an unknown state, we're going to do nothing. If it was critical, we're going to do something. If it was anything else, we're going to do nothing. So next slide, we're going to switch to the do fix it and the do nothings and the do somethings. So there's one service called workers, which actually needed to go do something when it was fired. And so it would, this was on a recovery, so it's a fix scenario. So it's firing off this restart process. The do nothing, it just logs and says, I didn't do anything. The do something, now we've determined that we've had to do something, maybe. But we're only going to do something. We've got this do soft, if it's a soft state, and if it's in a hard, this is a critical that brought us here. If it's a hard critical, we're going to go to our do restart function. So our do soft, if this is the third, fourth, or fifth time we've been here, then we're going to do our restart. Otherwise, we're not going to do anything. So what brought us to this screen is either we're a recovery for the one service that requires a recovery function, or we're a hard critical, or we are the third, fourth, or fifth soft critical. And the reason for that is because the way that our notification and escalation works is we tried to give Nagios time to actually fix the problem before telling people that there was a problem. So our actual restart does some stuff, does these lock files, it does the check commands to, or external commands to Nagios to disable various things. And then it fires off an SSH to the remote machine, passing in EK restart, appropriate location as its parameters. Here's our first parameter, or as the command line rather. Our first parameter is minus R, which is to do the client side code, do underscore name of service. So this would have been Apache or Tomcat or whatever. And then a whole bunch of parameters. And assuming that finishes, then the process tears down, logs, notifies, does what it ever needs to do, and exits. So at this point, that's the end. Everything above here is what happens on the Nagios host side. On the client side, it's the exact same script, except, again, that minus R at the beginning told us to flip down to the client code. So it does a bunch of stuff, figures out what those parameters were that got passed in, and then it just does an eval on the function name of what was passed in. So now it knows. For instance, one of the functions would be do underscore dynamo, because one of our class names is a dynamo machine. And it knows all the things that it needs to know to restart a dynamo instance running on a specific port, running on a specific machine. All that stuff is algorithmically computed or passed in through Nagios' service names and things like that. Teardown, after it's finished, it returns, which is returning back up to here, and it exits. So we have, this is kind of a hard way to look at it, I realize, but the idea was one script. And by combining sort of intelligent names of services and hosts inside of Nagios, service groups, machine, or host groups inside of Nagios, and then doing a little bit of math, essentially, inside of our restart script, we never have to make another restart script ever again. It just, you know, we fire up an Apache instance. It knows exactly how to restart an Apache instance based on the name of the machine and the name of the host or service inside of Nagios. So I talked a little bit about some of these things. We developed a homebrewed API that would allow us to get access to the Nagios configuration files. Again, we're talking Nagios version 1 something. You've got just a handful of configuration files, no database. All of these little end chart, send Nagios, end log, these are all things that made use of that API. So end chart was something that would let us pretend we were Nagios processing and parsing the configuration information so we could figure out what machines ran what services and so forth. It would also actually parse out the service check command configuration lines, including all the macro processing. So that if you wanted to know exactly what Nagios was going to execute, rather than looking at the web and GUI and looking at the configuration and try to parse all that on your own, you could just say, hey, Nagios, tell me, what are you going to execute? And it would fill in the blanks and give you a command line that you could cut and paste. And that would be the command check that Nagios was going to execute. Really useful for doing debugging for that. Send Nagios was our external command processor that would both parse the configurations and then send Nagios things like stop this service group from executing and so forth. Nlog was a log processor that would consolidate both what was in the configuration so that we could have human readable machine names and dates and so forth, so that we could then use that for our reporting, tell people how many times people got paged, how many times things got restarted, so forth. So this was all done essentially as homebrewed versions of a lot of the reporting functionality that came in later in some of the Nagios releases. All of this stuff ended up being integrated with the start and stop scripts that were used in general, so that if you were going to go log into a machine by hand for whatever reason and execute the restart script for one of the Apache servers, it's going to go tell Nagios, stop executing checks, not only for me, but for any service group that I'm a member of, because while that Apache server's down, other things are going to fail as well. So again, lock files all over the place, too many lock files. Lock files on the Nagios machine, lock files per service on Nagios, lock files on the remote machine, lock files in the start and stop scripts. I think we managed to get the lock files so that they would all build and, you know, pop off the stack appropriately, but every now and then lock files would get stuck. And every time that we used our API to go check for lock files, the API would say if the lock file is older than, I don't remember what it was, an hour, 3 hours, something like that, it would ignore the lock file. It figured it's, you know, time to move on at that point if you haven't successfully restarted. In 2004, these instances that were running the Kodak.com website would survive 4 or 5 days before they would kind of memory leak their way into needing to be restarted. In 2008, they'd last about 8 hours. So we invented this Rippler, which would go through and using a little bit of math, it would figure out what the sleep time was between restarting one instance, sleep, restart another instance. And it did this out of cron. We actually used our own EK restart script to do this restarting. We had Nagios run this Rippler so that it would just integrate automatically with all of the checks and the sort of complex dependencies that there were within the Nagios world for this environment. So that if the instance was starting to go bad because it's been up for 4 hours or 8 hours or whatever it is, Rippler's going to come along in 7 hours and restart it, hopefully before it goes bad. And because it's integrated using that EK restart, all of Nagios is just going to pause and ignore that machine or ignore that service while that service is being restarted. And then it's going to be told later with our send Nagios external command processor, okay, I can start checking again. And it will never even know that it was restarted. So on our uptime reports, they show 100%, even though we brought the service down, you know, 3 times a day through the Rippler. These days, we use a pager still with the text address. But now we have Twitter, that we have an API for Twitter that we use through a Perl script for our notifications. We have a lot of private Twitter feeds. So there's one for Apache, there's one for the Tomcat servers, there's one for whatever else. So you can subscribe to those, follow those, whatever the word is, from a smartphone or whatever. And we have a lot more flexibility in who gets notified than we used to. But there's still one cell phone that gets passed around from on-call person to on-call person every week. And they're the one who's actually responsible for fixing things. So since they get those notifications, one mailing list gets the notifications, there's been sort of add-on groups as Kodak has slashed, I'll say, its workforce and kind of spread out the work that each person is required to do. There's more and more groups that need to be involved in the applications that are on Kodak.com. So rather than worrying about changing notifications and contacts, we just run in with procmail and set up some rules so that if it's an Apache server, it gets sent off to the Apache people, but only if it's the business-to-business Apache people, for instance, or whatever the rules are that are appropriate for that particular service. So this thing that we call predictive failure recovery and a good night's sleep. So again, we're going to talk about Dynamo servers. So we had our soft critical is going to restart on our third failure, but we're actually and anytime we get a hard critical, we're going to always restart. But we're not going to notify anybody until the fourth failure. So this gives Nagios a chance to restart it before it tells anybody that there was a problem. So hopefully, if there was a small problem, we've stopped it from becoming a big problem. We haven't notified anybody. We haven't blasted out Twitter feeds. We haven't done this other stuff. And nobody needs to even really know that it got restarted, except there will be an email that says it got restarted. We escalate to a pager on the fifth problem. So at that point, we've actually had two attempted restarts by EK Restart. And if it can't restart it at that point, it probably needs human eyes and fingers to fix this problem. So the idea is that our dependencies and our interactions with EK Restart as sort of a master scheduler, if you will, of restarting things and locking other checks within Nagios means that we know whether we're looking at an application that's gone bad, are we looking at an entire server that's gone bad, or are we looking at a user experience that has gone bad. And obviously, if we've got a user experience problem, we have a big problem. If it's just an Apache server, yeah, we want to know about it, but like somebody was talking in one of the earlier things about one of the new features in Nagios Core, maybe, you can assign value to what some of these service outages mean. And an Apache server being out would be important, but low value. An entire production chain through our website to order a piece of hardware, that not working, that's big value, because there's millions of dollars at stake there. Again, with Twitter, we have private feeds now. With all the apps that will monitor Nagios on your smartphone, that means rather than actually getting woken up and having to log in and do something to acknowledge problems, you can just go click and be done with it in the middle of the night. So we have much more well-rested application support people that aren't getting notified as much as they used to. Those notifications are more meaningful. They're easier to deal with by the time they actually get to them. And I think that's it. So I realize it was a pretty broad brush through the Nagios world of the Kodak.com website, but kind of gives you an idea of some of the ways you can leverage sort of stock core Nagios with some programming aspects done at the shell level, perhaps, to get yourself something that probably looks a lot like XI if you really move in that direction. Questions? I'm good with no questions. Okay, thank you all. And I think got enough time to actually maybe change clothes before we go to Nicolette Island. So thank you.